Paul McGuire Grimes, KSTP, Minneapolis, St. Paul. Peter, Paris, Julie, Michael, it is so great talking to you. Julie and Paris, I actually met you a couple years ago at the Alamo Draft House. I moderated a Q&A with both of you, and it was so much fun. So it is great to have all four of you now together again. This is fantastic. So thank you.
It was well, my first trip to Minneapolis, and it was lovely. I had a great time.
Yes, that's awesome. Oh, it's so great to hear. Thank you, Julie. Peter, I want to start with you. What do you remember working with Gene Wilder? What did he stay in character? What was he like offset?
Oh, yeah. Very patient with me. he was just a great guy, you know, very easy to work with. Was kind of my mentor on the film, both he and Jack. Mm-hmm. Just nothing but fond memories of working with Gene. When he first got, I actually arrived a little bit sooner than Gene did to Munich to start filming. And we did all the running scenes initially of Charlie delivering the papers. And I can remember the very first time I met him, he gave me a big hug and he said, if I see you run one more scene, I don't know what I'm going to do. So he just, and I had never met Gene before. And I had just seen, in New York, a film that he was just released that, is kind of in the archives now, Quaxer Fortune Has a Cousin in the Bronx. Oh, so look, find that, but it's a great film. And I saw that in New York City, you know, en route to Munich, that I'm going to be working with this guy. So just, I have fond memories of Gene. He was, you know, quality individual.
Oh my, that means a lot. Just hearing what he was like, you know, in person, behind the scenes of someone that's that kind of a legend. Michael, take us through seeing the set for the first time, especially the chocolate factory. Is the reaction that we see in the movie all of your first time? Julie, I have a follow-up for you after this too.
And of course, the chocolate room was bombastic. There was a big chocolate river and a big chocolate waterfall. But the bad news was the chocolate was not of chocolate, but of water. And I have to jump in there, and it was very, very cold.
Now, Julie, if I remember correctly, you said that you saw it before everyone else did. Can you share that story?
Yeah, well, I was on location a little earlier as well to record my song. And whilst I was going past one day, the soundstage door, which was open, Harper Goff said, oh, do you want to see the set? It was being constructed at the time, the Pure Imagination Room. And of course, I said yes. And he showed me around. It wasn't finished, but, you know, there I could see the grass happening and the trees and the mushrooms and things like that. And then a little bit later, we were walking past and Mel Stewart said, you know, on no account let the kids see this room, you know, because I want to record their initial reaction. They mustn't see it. It's got to be a total surprise, you know. And Mel Stewart was a little bit shouty, our director. He was a bit intimidating and I was rather terrified of him. So I just kept quiet. It's like, I can't tell him, I've already seen it. So I never said a word. I never told anybody until many, many years later. 30 odd years later, maybe we were at the 30th anniversary or the 40th, I forget. And he was telling the story again about shooting our original reaction. And I was thinking, I can't let him go on with this delusion. So I told him, and he was apoplectic. His language was colorful. He was, that's all I will say. Colorful language. I came clean eventually.
Right. Now, Paris, it's been 50 years. What does this movie mean to you? And has that changed over your life?
It has changed because I started acting when I was 6. So I'd already done a lot of work by the time I got to 11. So when I booked it, it was just kind of a film, although it was in Europe, which was cool because I got to go there with my family. I read the book for my audition piece, you know, scenes from. And so I knew at that point that it was going to be special because it was going to have all these fantastic places like the beautiful chocolate room designed by Harper Goff, who did some other things at Disney and so forth, which, by the way, was like having your own private Disneyland ride built just for you. And then it kind of came and went a little bit. And then over time, it became a cult classic. So in a sense, its importance in my life grew starting, let's say, 25 years ago until now, more and more with each succeeding year as people, dare I say it, I'm embarrassed to say, sometimes parallel it with things like The Wizard of Oz, which, you know, obviously is as big as it gets in terms of this kind of film. So, changes my life, changes, and always in a positive way, the influence in my life.
That's beautiful. Because we, you know, we grow up with a movie like this that means a lot to so many people. And to hear all four of you have such great fond memories of it and love talking about it is really special. So thank you so much for the time today. I appreciate it. And this is a real treat. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you. Yeah.